Hi friends, welcome to Easy Ways. So welcome to this particular series wherein we are going to have a discussion regarding the previous year questions of CLAT examination, right? So this particular video caters to legal aptitude section. So friends, we shall be discussing 10 questions taken from CLAT 2018 paper. So we have already discussed at length regarding the importance of previous year questions for any competitive examination. So friends, whether you are a beginner or you are at the later stage of your preparation, anyone, any CLAT aspirant can watch this video and gain the maximum out of it. So friends, if you want to take the test first so that you can practice and get yourself tested whether you know that or not, and then you want to come back to this video solution, you can go to our website www.easyway.co.in. If you are already our subscriber, you can log in or you can sign up, then enroll in the free course and then continue taking the test. So friends, now the first question for today that we're going to discuss is regarding Article 51A of the Fundamental Duties. So the question says, Article 51A of the Fundamental Duties was inserted into the Constitution of India through the what? Now friends, what we need to infer from this particular question, first thing, it is from constitutional law. The second thing, they are asking about important amendments, okay? So now, you guys, whoever is watching the video, the first thing that should strike your mind is, in constitutional law, you need to keep a list of all the important amendments to the Constitution, okay? So the answer for this particular question, so friends, the answer for this particular question is 42nd Constitution Amendment Act 1976, right friends? So now you should never forget that the Article 51A, which talks about the fundamental duties, was inserted through this particular constitutional amendment, right? So friends, here's a list of some of the important provisions of the 42nd Amendment Act 1976, okay? So first, talking about the preamble, so you can see that there was a substitution of words. So instead of sovereign democratic republic, it was replaced by sovereign socialist secular democratic republic. So there were additions of two important terms, socialist and secular, okay? And the words unity of the nation was substituted with unity and integrity of the nation. Then the next important thing, there were important directives, that is under directive principles of state policy, there were certain new articles added. You can see here it is 39A, 43A and 48A. There is also the explanation of the articles here. Next, if you see, we have just now seen that the fundamental duties were added through this particular amendment act. It is there in the part 4A of the constitution and article is 51A. Right? So here, this is also one important takeaway. They can be very simple question like which of the following parts of the constitution contains fundamental duties, okay? Or which of the following articles deals with fundamental duties. So here's a lot of points that you need to note, right friends? Then you can see some of the important amendments regarding the transferring of subjects like the forest, education, weights and measures, except establishment of standards, protection of wild animals and birds from the state list, it was moved to the concurrent list. So as we know that there are three important lists. One is your union list, state list and concurrent list. So the subjects which are there in concurrent list, both the union government and the state governments can frame laws on those subjects. Okay. There was also a new entry 20A that was added in the concurrent list, which was called population control and family planning. Right. Now, last one, there was an amendment which was made in Article 356 of the Constitution. Now, this particular article deals with president's rule, right, in the state, and here you can see that the duration, okay, up to which a president's rule can go on without renewal was 6 months. So that was extended to 1 year through this particular amendment, which is Article 356 of the Constitution, okay. Next important question, friend, the second one is the highest law officer in India is. So again, friends, it's a very simple question, friends, direct question. Here you can see that you don't need to apply anything, any, you know, principle, or you don't need to have any prior knowledge about something else. You just need to know the facts. Okay. So this is again taken again from the constitutional law as a subject. Okay. And let us see the answer for this particular question. So the answer is first one, it is Attorney General, right friends? So now friends, I would say that, you know, it is very important that you don't go wrong in these kinds of questions, okay? The first one and the second, they are very simple, straightforward questions. You just need to know that you need to have a list of important amendments of the Constitution. Secondly, the important provisions, whether be it the Prime Minister, the President or the Chief Minister or the Governor, okay? So all these important personalities you need to be aware of. Now let us just continue about Attorney General of India. So the Article 76 of the Constitution tells about the Attorney General of India, right? So you can say that the power is derived from this particular article. So this can again be a probable question. You need to know the article number, okay? Now the Attorney General of India can be called by various names, okay? He is called the highest law officer of the country. This is one important point. The Indian government's chief legal advisor, okay? Second important point. Primary lawyer in the Supreme Court. So wherever you encounter these terms, they are referring to Attorney General of India. Fine, friends. One other thing that I've noted here is that he is not a member of the cabinet. He does not have any executive authority. He is neither a political appointee. Okay. Next thing, terms of office. So there is no particular number of years that is mentioned in the Constitution, but it is mentioned that under Article 76(1). The Attorney General of India would hold office during the pleasure of the President, and who appoints him? It is the President of India. So you can also get a very simple question that who appoints Attorney General of India? So it is the President of India. Right, friends? Now moving to eligibility, right? Again, there is a very simple thing that is mentioned that a person who can be appointed as an Attorney General of India should be equivalent to the judge of the Supreme Court in terms of your eligibility. Okay, so that means if a person is eligible to be appointed as a judge of the Supreme Court, then that person can be appointed as the Attorney General. Okay, so now you need to know the qualifications to be a judge of a Supreme Court. So again, this is a probable question. You might get a question like this also in the examination. So firstly, he needs to be a citizen of India. So he must have been a judge of some high court for 5 years. Okay, or he must have been an advocate of some high court for nearly 10 years. Or an eminent jurist in the opinion of the President. So we have just now seen that it is the President who appoints the Attorney General. So friends, talking about terms of office, so obviously the Attorney General is the term is not fixed by the Constitution, as I have already mentioned. And Attorney General is eligible for reappointment, but after being reappointed, he cannot serve more than 3 years. Okay. Nextly, regarding removal also, we do not have any concrete article, or we do not have it explicitly mentioned in the Constitution. No. Okay. And but it is mentioned that Attorney General would hold the office during the pleasure of the President. So that means that he may be removed by the President. Okay. So this is something that we need to infer. Now, obviously, the Attorney General can quit his office. So but before doing that, he needs to submit the resignation to the President. So again, this also can be a question, friends, that Attorney General submits a resignation to which of the following personalities? Okay. Then usually the convention is Attorney General resigns when the government resigns or is replaced, okay? Because the President appoints the Attorney General based on the advice of the Council of Ministers, okay? So that is why this convention is seen. But again, this is not mentioned in the Constitution. You need to understand that, okay? Talking about remuneration, it is again not fixed by the Constitution, okay? So here talking about roles or responsibilities, okay, so first very basic responsibility is giving advice to the government of India on legal matters, okay, and these legal matters are going to be referred to him by the President. So we already saw he's the highest law officer. So what a law officer would do, we need to, you know, use that particular, you can say, common sense out here, okay. So when we are saying that Attorney General is the highest law officer, so obviously he would actually be involved in giving advice to the government of India. Okay, and here also you can see that what are the duties which the President has assigned to the Attorney General. So he appears on behalf of the government of India in all the cases of the Supreme Court. Okay, and also he can represent the government of India in any reference which is made by the President to the Supreme Court under Article 143 of the Constitution. So friends, here also you need to understand that, you know, mainly just you understand one thing, that advising on legal matters, okay, representing the government of India in all cases in the Supreme Court, this is the second point that you need to remember. Also, one important point is he also is required to appear in any high court in any case in which the government of India is concerned. Okay, so again, in High Court, Attorney General would be representing the government of India, that is the Union Government. Okay, so these are the roles and responsibilities on an overall basis. You need to know this, right? Next, the rights of Attorney General. Okay, so Attorney General has the right of audience in all courts in the territory of India. So he has the right to be present there. Okay, secondly, Attorney General also has the right to speak as well as take part in the proceedings of both the houses of the parliament, okay, as well as their joint committee or any committee which specifically requires Attorney General to be there, okay, or any committee which has Attorney General as its member, okay. But friends, understand one important point here. Right to speak is there, right to take part is there, but right to vote is not there. This is the catch, okay? So this can be a probable question. So Attorney General has the right to speak, has the right to take part, but does not have a right to vote, okay? This is very important, okay? Next, what is the limitation, friends? So obviously, if Attorney General is required to represent the government of India, he cannot appear against the government of India. Okay. The second point is he should not defend accused persons in criminal prosecutions without the permission of government of India. Okay. Also, he cannot accept any appointment, okay, in any company or corporation, again, without the permission of the government of India. So because he is the highest law officer of India, there are a lot of responsibilities on his or her shoulder, and that's why these are the limitations placed on the Attorney General. Now friends, talking about private practice, so since we saw that he is the highest law officer of India, do you think he's not allowed to do a private practice? No, it is not the case. Okay, he's not a full-time government servant. This one is a very important point. He can take a private practice, okay, but in that particular case, the government of India should not be a participant. Okay, this is important. Okay, so here I've written one note here. Okay, you can also pause the video, have a look at it. So friends, now these are some of the other important points that I've jotted down. Okay, you can pause the video and have a look at it. There's nothing much to explain. You can just read yourself as well. Okay, now we are coming to the third question for this discussion. So friends, how many languages are there in the 8th schedule of the Constitution of India? Now again, friends, where do I put this question in? It is a very simple factual based question, okay, where you just need to know. You don't need to apply any concept or understanding here. The answer for this particular question is 22 languages are there in the 8th schedule of the Constitution of India. So friends, now you need to understand that so far we have seen first, second and third question. Okay, all these three questions were taken from the Constitution of India. Okay, now the first question again was a very simple fact-based question where you needed to know about the important amendments of the Constitution. Again, the second question was about the Attorney General. Very simple. They did not ask about the appointment or removal or maybe, you know, salary or fixed term. They just asked who is the highest law officer in India. Okay, so again, this is a very simple question that we came across. The third one is also very simple. They're just asking you how many languages are there in the 8th schedule of the Constitution of India. Okay. So friends, here you can have a look at the list of the languages. There are 22 languages, as I told you. Now, I would recommend you all to pause this video. At least have a look at the names of these languages once. Okay. Now, the recently added languages are Bodo, Dogri, Maithili and Santhali. Okay. Let me tell you, there can also be a question regarding languages. They might ask you languages in the options and you might be asked to pick which one of the following is not one of the languages present in the 8th schedule of the Indian Constitution. So that can be a probable question. That's why I'm asking you to have a look at the names. So friends, now having a look at question number 4. So it says a panchayat samiti at the block level in India is what? Now let me first tell you the answer and then we will go back to the explanation. The answer is coordinating and supervisory authority. Okay. So friends, let me just tell you one or two points here that whenever you hear the term panchayats, okay, this is nothing but the rural local self-government in India. So this particular term, immediately you need to connect it to this important amendment of our constitution, which is called 73rd Amendment Act of 1992. Okay, and whenever you hear the term municipalities, okay, here you need to relate this to the 74th Amendment Act of 1992. Okay, so 73rd Amendment Panchayats, 74th Amendment municipalities. This can also be a probable question. That's why I'm asking you to remember these things. Okay. So with this Amendment Act of 1992, there was a new part that was added to the Constitution, which is part 9. Okay, so till now we have also seen one important part at the start of this lecture. I'm not going to say which important part is that, but that was related to fundamental duties. Now, by now, you should tell me the answer. Okay, so this part was titled Panchayats consists of provisions from articles 243 to 243O. Okay, so it was obviously titled Panchayats only. So here it also added a new schedule, which is the 11th schedule. Okay, so again, these are important things. So what is Amendment Act 73rd? Panchayats, Rural Local Self-Government in India, Part 9 and Schedule 11. Okay, so never forget all these things. So friends, when we talk about rural self-government, when you talk about Panchayati Raj, you need to understand that the 73rd Amendment Act 1992 brought in a lot of provisions with it. Okay, so one of those salient features of it was a three-tier system of Panchayati Raj that needs to exist in every state. Okay, so the three-tier system means that the rural government at the level of village, okay, intermediate level as well as district level. Okay, friends. Now you need to understand that the question that we were referring to was regarding Panchayat Samiti. Okay, so this is the rural government or the self-government which is present at this intermediate level. This is important. So it is called by various names. It is called Mandals, Taluka Panchayat, Block Panchayat or even Panchayat Samiti. So basically you can see that since it is at the intermediate level, it forms a link between the district level and the village level. So you can say that it one of its functions is to coordinate and supervise as well, right? So that is why the principal function can be classified as coordinating the activities of the various panchayat which is there within its jurisdiction. Okay, friends. Now also it scrutinizes their budgets. Okay, and also it reserves the right to suggest some measures for improving the functioning of the panchayats at the village level. Right. So you need to understand that we are talking about Panchayat Samiti, which comes at the intermediate level, forming a link between the district level and the village level. Right. Now coming to question number 5, friends, which of the following is not a fundamental duty as per the provisions of the Constitution of India? So friends, at the start of this particular lecture, we saw a particular question wherein it was regarding constitutional amendment, wherein we are asking about 42nd Amendment Act 1976. Okay. Now this particular question again is taken from fundamental duties, right? So you can see that first 5 questions that we were discussing was from constitutional law, right? Now this is a very simple question. If you have memorized all the fundamental duties, or at least if you have read the fundamental duties once, you would be able to answer this question immediately. So the answer for this particular question, friends, it is to join the defense forces in India. This is not one of the fundamental duties contained in the Constitution of India, right? So friends, here you can see that as of now, we have 11 fundamental duties. Okay, and what are the things that you need to keep in mind? One is the part 4A of the Constitution. Okay, and Article 51A, if you remember. Right, so it pertains to FD, fundamental duties. So here I have listed down all the fundamental duties. Pause the video and then and there finish this fundamental duties. You might get a direct question from this particular area. Right. So again, here you can see that there is to defend the country and render national service when called upon to do so. This called upon to do so is the keyword, friends. Right. This is very important. So whenever you are reading a particular fundamental duty, or for that matter, even DPSP or fundamental rights, read that completely. Understand the essence of it. So it is the duty of a citizen to defend the country and render national service when they are called to do so. OK, there this called to do so is not there. That is why it is a very general statement. And that is why that particular option stands to be incorrect. You need to understand that. Okay. So here as well, you can see the duties. I'm not going to read it again here. That's why you can take your time, pause the video and have a look at it. Here again, the last two out here. So friends, now coming to question number 6, it says the Right to Education Act 2009, RTE, provides for free and compulsory education to which of the following segments, right? So friends, the answer for this particular question is option number 3, which is children aged between 6 and 14 years. So this is a revolutionary act that actually came into force on 1st of April 2010. So this act provides free and compulsory education for children between 6 and 14 years in India. Right, friends? Now, what is the key takeaway from such questions? That whatever are important acts, okay, you need to be aware of those acts, in which year were they actually implemented, plus what is the target audience or the target population, These are some of the important factors, friends. You need to keep them in mind, right? And now elaborating upon this particular act. So friends, since this we are talking about Right to Education Act, let me tell you a very important article which relates to the same thing. And in fact, Right to Education Act was implemented to give effect to that particular article that we're going to study. So it is called 21A of the Indian Constitution. It is a fundamental right, and this particular article was added through a constitutional amendment, which is the 86th Amendment Act 2002. So basically, Article 21A says that in India we need to provide free and compulsory education to all children of age group 6 to 14 years. So this is made a fundamental right, and to give effect to this particular fundamental right, we have an act which is called Right to Education Act. We just now saw that important question, right, friends? So friends, now let us come to question number 7. So basically, this is assertion and reason type of question. Okay, so till now we were having a look at simple questions wherein you have a question and four options. You need to directly go and select the correct answer. Now this particular question is a bit different pattern. So wherein you have a assertion given. Assertion means a statement. Okay, first we need to judge whether that statement is correct or not. Okay, so it says it is the legal and constitutional duty of the state to provide legal aid to the poor. Okay, now friends, this is one of the provisions in the Constitution of India. It is one of the directive principles of state policy. Okay, so if you know DPSP properly, you will know that yes, this particular statement stands to be true, because they are saying it is the legal and constitutional duty. Okay, it derives its power from the Constitution. Yes, so now see the four options that is given below. So you know now that assertion is true. Okay, so obviously this particular option is ruled out. Okay, that A is false but R is true. This we can cancel because we know for sure that assertion is true. Now look for the reason. See if this is the correct reason for this particular statement. Now read out that no one should be denied justice by reason of his poverty. So now friends, how will you judge whether this particular reason suits the statement or not? See, here they have clearly mentioned legal aid to the poor. Okay, so when they have mentioned poor very specifically, we can immediately relate to the fact that no one should be denied justice by reason of his poverty. So this poor and poverty validates the reason that is given, and that is why the correct option should be what? It should be both A and R are individually true. That is, if I see them as separate statements, they are true. Also, R is the correct explanation of A. Okay, friends, so there can be a situation when both A and R are true, but R is not the correct reason for A to happen. But here it is correct reason for A to happen. Okay. Now here again, friends, as I told you, this is one of the DPSP, Directive Principles of State Policy, Article 39A. Okay, so now we are also doing revision, friends, side by side, you can see. So Article 39A talks about giving free legal aid, equal justice. Okay, you can just read this article, you will understand that it talks about the free legal aid that is given. Now coming to question 8, friends, which was the law that was introduced by Sir William Bentinck to prohibit the practice of sati? Now this particular answer is Bengal Sati Regulation 1829. Okay, friends, so this is a very direct question. Okay, and you cannot say that you need to have an understanding about a particular concept to answer this particular question. Coming to question number 9, friends, so basically again this is a next pattern of a question that you're seeing here. So far we have seen two patterns. One is your direct question being given and you have four options, choose the answer. Second is we saw assertion and reason based questions. Okay, so for assertion and reason based, first check whether both the statements are correct. Okay, and then see if R is the correct reason for A. Okay, that is what we have done in the last question. Now here comes next important type of a pattern that is usually seen. It is legal principle fact situation based questions. So basically what is going to happen is they're going to give you a legal principle. Okay, you need to read this legal principle and apply that principle on this fact situation. So let me tell you, friends, sometimes what happens is the legal principle might not be literally true, but you need to assume it to be true. okay, because it is given as a legal principle there. Okay, so it says nothing is an offense if committed by a child below 7 years of age. So very simply they are saying, if there is a child and the child is below 7 years, if that child is committing a mistake or something, that is not going to be called an offense. Understand that. Okay, now see the situation. Adil, age 6 years, is a student of class 1. Okay, he's 6 years. Okay, so here you can see that since he's 6 years, he's falling under the category that they are talking about in the legal principle, below 7 years of age. Okay, so is a student of class 1. He placed his sharpened pencil on the bench with its pointed end up, and when his classmate Ajay stood up to answer a question from the teacher, Ajay gets hurt when he sits on the pencil, and Adil and his friends have a good laugh. Ajay's father, on seeing his son injured when he returns home, wants action against Adil. Okay, which of the following statements is the most appropriate in relation to the legal principle which is stated above? Now friends, the answer for this particular question is Adil has not committed any offense. Very simple friends. Why is it like that? So you need to understand, they have clearly stated in the legal principle that nothing is an offense if a child below 7 years of age commits it. Okay, so now we already saw Adil is how many years? He is 6 years of age. That is why whatever mistake that he has committed, we cannot classify that mistake as an offense. Right? Very simple. So friends, coming to the last question for discussion in this lecture. So let me just tell you, so far, okay, in this lecture, we have realized that there are three important types of questions that are there in the examination. One is just straightforward question with four options. Second is assertion reason based questions. Okay, we have solved them as well. Now we are also having a look at legal principle fact situation based questions. Okay, so those who are new, they would get an idea that, okay, these are the kind of questions that we could encounter in the exam. And those who are already through their preparation, they can at least, you know, have an idea, okay, that these are the areas that we need to cover, right? Okay, so let me just tell you that when you come across these legal principle fact situation based questions, there are one or two points that would help you out. Let me just tell you, the first point is keep your previous understanding of that particular subject aside when you're reading that legal principle. Okay, whatever legal principle is given, based on that only you need to solve the question. Very well, keep this point in mind. Okay, second thing, having said that, it is obvious that your previous understanding of that particular question will help you. How it would help you? Like here, if you see in this question, you can see this words basic structure, okay, and you can see basic features, you can see judicial review. Okay, so basically we are talking about two important concepts in the constitution here. One is basic structure of the constitution, and another is judicial review. So if you already are aware of these two terms, definitely solving this question is going to be easier for you. Right, friends? Okay, now let us solve this question. So the legal principle says the doctrine of basic structure in constitutional jurisprudence means that the Constitution of India has certain basic features that cannot be taken away through amendments by the Parliament. Okay, the power of judicial review is a part of the basic structure, and it helps the constitutional courts to determine whether an amendment is against the basic structure or not. So they're talking about two concepts. One is they're saying that in our constitution, there are certain basic features, okay, and those basic features cannot be taken away by the Parliament through any amendment. These are the essence of a constitution. Okay, one point here, friends, just for your knowledge, that the basic structures are not explicitly mentioned in the constitution. Nowhere you will find the mention of basic structure of constitution in the constitution. Okay, so this has evolved over a period of time through various judgments given by the courts. Okay, we will see that in the later section. Okay, next is this power of judicial review, which is related to Article 13 of the Indian Constitution, which is again a fundamental right. Okay, so this particular legal principle that they are saying, first point they are saying about basic structure, and they are saying that these basic structures cannot be taken away through amendments by the Parliament. Second thing they are saying, that there is a power of judicial review which is also a part of that basic structure, and using this judicial review, what can be done is the courts can determine whether an amendment is against the basic structure or not. Very simple, two important concepts merged here. Okay, now fact situation. They are saying Parliament proposes an amendment to limit the power of appeal against the conviction for the offences of sedition to be exercised only by the Supreme Court of India. So the fact situation is, there is an amendment which is proposed by the Parliament. Okay, so now what is the question? Which of the following statement is the most appropriate in relation to the legal principle stated above? Let us go to the options. The first option says the proposed amendment is against the doctrine of basic structure. Now friends, this answer is not correct. Why it is not correct? Here straight away we are giving a judgment. We are saying the proposed amendment is against the doctrine of basic structure. But if you read the fact situation, it is just saying that the bill has been proposed, the amendment has been proposed, okay? And now we don't know whether that is against the basic structure or not. So this is ruled out. Second option, the proposed amendment is unconnected to the doctrine of basic structure. Again, how can we infer that the proposed amendment is unconnected to the doctrine of basic structure? We have no clue. There is no word that the court has given on that particular amendment, right? Third option, the proposed amendment can be reviewed and struck down by the constitutional courts. Now read this particular sentence. They are saying the amendment that the parliament has proposed can be reviewed and the constitutional court can strike it down. Now this statement stands to be correct. Why? Because already in the legal principle, it is clearly given that the power of judicial review is such that they can determine whether an amendment is against the basic structure or not. Okay, so if they can determine that, obviously they have the power to strike it down, right? The last option, the proposed amendment is beyond the power of the parliament. Again, we cannot infer that from the fact situation that is given, right friends? So as I told you, the answer is the third one. The proposed amendment can be reviewed and struck down by the constitutional courts. So friends, now here we can have a look at the doctrine of basic structure of the Indian Constitution. So basically, as I told you that this is a feature wherein there are certain important points or there are certain important provisions that cannot be altered or destroyed. Now, why cannot they be altered or destroyed? Because they are considered to be the essence of the Indian Constitution. So when we deal with Indian Constitution as a chapter separately, you will be able to understand these things in a better way. Right? So now again, as I told you, they have not been explicitly defined by the judiciary. They are not there explicitly in the Constitution. It would not be written, okay, basic structures of the Constitution, A, B, C, D. No, we will not find that. Okay? It is determined by the courts in each case that is coming up in front of them. Okay? Now, what are the basic structures of the Indian Constitution? Now, where is this list given? Obviously, as I told you, through various judgments that we come across, the courts realize that, okay, this is something which is, you know, a very integral part of our Constitution. If we take this structure away, our Constitution would lose its meaning, okay? I've just written down some examples here, okay? Like you have fundamental rights, okay? You have supremacy of the Indian Constitution. You have republican and democratic form of government, okay? Imagine if we are transforming overnight to a dictatorship. So that is not going to happen because our constitution does not stand for those ideals. Okay, so we cannot take away this feature like republican or democratic form of government. Okay, these ought to stay there. Okay, secular character of the constitution, federal character, maintenance of the separation of power, sovereignty of the country, maintenance of the unity and integrity of India. Right, friends? Okay, so Article 13, again, there was a word which was called the power of judicial review. As I told you, this is part of fundamental rights, okay? And it actually says that all laws that are inconsistent with or in derogation of any fundamental right shall be void, okay? Now, friends, you need to understand one thing that, again, it is not expressively mentioned that, this article does not explicitly state that this is power of judicial review. Okay, you need to understand these are inferences that we have gained over a period of time. Okay, so you can just pause this video, have a look at this particular section regarding Article 13 of the Indian Constitution, right? So friends, with this, we are at the end of this particular lecture. So friends, I know half an hour, it might be a little too long for you, but friends, believe me, you need to spend that much of time so that you are aware of the kind of questions, how to approach a question, what are the kind of areas that we need to cover, right? In the next part, we shall come up with the next 10 questions from CLAT 2018 paper. So friends, if you have any doubt regarding strategy, time management, you can mail us at mail@easyway@gmail.com. You can give us a call on 8968984790. And if you really found this video useful, do like and share and do subscribe to our YouTube channel. Press the bell icon so that you get notification whenever we come up with a new video. Till then, friends, as I always tell you all, keep practicing, keep revising. Thank you so much.